Good morning, everybody. The committee will come to order. This morning, we're going to meet to mark up a total of 7 bipartisan bills, all of which have my full support, and all of which, should they become law, would improve the benefits and services that are provided to our nation's veterans by the Department of Veterans Affairs. I'm grateful to the ranking member, Ms. Brown, our subcommittee chairman and ranking members, and the sponsor of the bills on today's agenda for their efforts to advance these pieces of legislation to the full committee. Since we have a full agenda today, I'm going to forego an opening statement, yield to the ranking member for any opening statement she may have.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We have a number of bills before us and a number of amendments. I will keep my opening remarks brief this morning and address a few issues. First, at the appropriate time, I will be offering an amendment to the chairman's amendment regarding reform of the VA construction program. My amendment will require that there be a determination regarding the complexity of a project in addition to a dollar level requirement in order to classify a construction project as a super construction project. I believe that this will lead to better use of the project management skills of the entity and will be brought to in to manage these projects. We all know that these entities most likely will be the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. Those of us serve on the Transportation Committee know that this agency has many responsibilities. I believe that my amendment will better serve to get the VA the help it needs on these projects where it needs help. Secondly, and this is a real concern, over provisions in the H.R. 3016 that would transfer a job program from the Department of Labor to the VA. I'm totally against this. Now it's not the time to mandate that the VA adds an entity, new bureaucrat, and be responsible for a program it has no real proven expertise in. There are simply too many questions as to how such a transfer from DOL to VA would occur and how this might affect the ability of veterans to find jobs and pursue careers. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And with that, I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you very much. I would call up H.R. 677. The clerk shall report.
H.R. 677, to amend Title 38 United States Code to provide for annual cost of living adjustments to be made automatically by law each year in the rates of disability compensation for veterans with service-connected disabilities and the rates of dependency and indemnity compensation for
the
survivors.
The bill has been circulated in advance pursuant to committee rules, and without objection, the first reading shall be dispensed with. The bill is now open for amendment at any point.
Mr. Chairman, I have an amendment in the nature of substitute at the desk.
Dr. Abraham, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This amendment in the nature of a substitute is a result of the hard work and commitment of several committee members to find bipartisan solutions for our nation's veterans. In the interest of time,
Dr.
I won't
Abraham,
go in.
If you'll suspend for just a moment.
I will.
The clerk shall report.
An amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 677 offered by Mr. Abraham of Louisiana.
I ask unanimous consent that further reading of the amendment be dispensed with, in the nature of a substitute be dispensed with, hearing no objections, so ordered. I recognize Dr. Abraham again.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This amendment in the nature of the substitute is a result of the hard work and commitment of several committee members to find bipartisan solutions for our nation's veterans. In the interest of time, I won't go into detail about every provision included in ANS and will instead focus on remarks on the ANS provisions derived from the bills that I'm proud to have introduced. My bill, H.R. 677, would authorize an automatic annual COLA for VA disability benefits without requiring additional congressional action. Although Congress generally approves legislation that provides a COLA for veterans benefits payments, the current process leaves veterans and their families who depend on these benefits to make ends meet in limbo until Washington actually passes the legislation. H.R. 677 would end this uncertainty and ensure that our nation's veterans and their dependents would automatically receive the same annual COLA as Social Security recipients. This will enable VA beneficiaries to better plan for their financial future. The ANS also includes provisions from another bill I've introduced, H.R. 2214, which would make it more convenient for veterans to schedule disability examinations by extending through 2017 the temporary authorization that allows VA to use contract physicians for this purpose. VA may afford medical examinations to veterans seeking disability benefits, but there's often a long wait time before this examination can be scheduled within the VA. To reduce the pending examination backlog, in 2003, Congress gave VA temporary authority to contract with private physicians to perform disability examinations. However, this authority expires at the end of this year, and the ANS to H.R. 677 would extend authority through December 31, 2017. Veterans in rural areas, like the District 5 that I'm proud to represent, may have to travel long distances to get their VA healthcare facility in order to see a VA examiner for a disability examination. It can be especially difficult to schedule these examinations if the veteran needs to see a specialist, such as an orthopedic surgeon. The ANS to H.R. 677 would also make it more convenient for veterans to schedule disability examinations by permitting licensed physicians to conduct these examinations anywhere in the United States, as long as the doctor has a current unrestricted license and is not barred from practicing medicine within the United States or its territories. Finally, the ANS includes provisions derived from my bill H.R. 245, which require the VA to provide this committee with quarterly reports on formal and informal claims for benefits. We will be able to use this data and these reports to better inform our legislation to reform VA's procedures and improve services for veterans. The ANS also expresses a sense of Congress that VA should streamline the application process for veterans who seek to reopen their claims or file for an increase in benefits. I want to recognize the hard work of members whose proposals have been incorporated into this ANS, particularly our colleagues on the committee, Chairman Miller, Dr. Ruiz, Mr. Waltz, and Mr. O'Rourke. In addition, I want to acknowledge the contributions of Representative Johnson, Butterfield, Latta, Rosair, and Frankel. Mr. Chairman, I also want to thank you, Ranking Member Brown, and all the members of the committee for your efforts on behalf of our nation's veterans. I urge my colleagues to support each and every one of these provisions in the ANS to H.R. 677, and I yield back.
Thank you very much, Dr. Abraham. As he just said, the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 677 incorporates a bill I'm proud to have introduced, H.R. 1380. The provisions would expand eligibility for a medallion provided by the VA, which signifies the veteran status of a deceased individual. These medallions are inscribed with the word veteran across the top and the branch of service at the bottom. The medallions may be affixed to a privately purchased headstone or marker and is furnished upon request for eligible veterans who died on or after November 1st of 1990. My proposal would expand this benefit to every veteran who served in the armed forces after April 6th of 1917, the date the United States entered the First World War. I note that these markers are not given to every deceased veteran, but are provided only on request. This request is usually made by the family members of a deceased veteran who choose to affix such a medallion to their loved one's grave marker in a private cemetery. The reasons that these medallions are available to veterans who died after the 31st of October of 1990 is because from the 1st of November of 1990 through September 11th of 2001, VA did not pay a benefit for the purchase of a private headstone or marker for veterans who were qualified for interment in a national or a state veteran cemetery. Therefore, the medallions provide a way of distinguishing the privately purchased headstones of our nation's heroes. The medallions have proven to be very much appreciated by the veterans and their families. During a Disability Assistance and Memorial Affairs Subcommittee hearing, VA testified that it has been forced to deny 91% of the applications for these medallions because the requests were made by families of veterans who died prior to November 1 of 1990. Although the original proposal would have provided this medallion to every veteran, regardless of the date of death, the legislation has been amended to respond to concerns raised by the National Cemetery Administration and AMVETS during the June 24, 2015 hearing on this proposal. The NCA and AMVETS testified that affixing medallions to older headstones could actually cause damage. Further, the medallions would alter the appearance of cemeteries, which is a special concern for historic cemeteries that include the graves of veterans who served in the military prior to the First World War. Therefore, to preserve both the integrity of the old headstones and the landscape of historic cemeteries, this legislation would restrict eligibility of those medallions to veterans who served in the armed forces after April 6th of 1917, as was suggested by the Cemetery Administration. But for me, the most important consideration is that the purpose of these medallions is to ensure that people visiting cemeteries are able to identify the final resting place of our nation's veterans. I hope that everyone, including those in future generations who see one of these medallions, will take a few minutes to honor the service and sacrifice of those who fought to defend our freedom. Our nation's heroes deserve nothing less. I urge my colleagues to support this provision in the amendment in the nature of the substitute to H.R. 677, and would ask now if there's any further discussion on the amendment in the nature of substitute.
Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Brown.
I have a quick question.
Yes, ma'am.
Do you have what the medallion look like?
There is not a design available for you to look at this point, but I'd be glad to make it available to you.
The minority would appreciate that.
Sure. Dr. Ruiz.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Ms. Ranking Member, for holding today's markup and including the language from two of my bills, H.R. 732, the Veterans Access to Speedy Review Act, and H.R. 2691, the Veterans Survivor Claims Processing Automation Act. These simple, common-sense bills will streamline the benefits process for veterans' families, help veterans who need benefits most gain priority processing, and expand the VA's capacity to process appeals without imposing additional costs. I also want to thank Chairman Abraham for amending his bill, H.R. 677, the American Heroes COLA Act, to include these critical measures to get veterans their benefits sooner and reduce the backlog at the VA. The Veterans Access to Speedy Review Act will provide the VA the flexibility they need and have requested before this committee to expand the use of video teleconferencing for hearings before the Board of Veterans Appeals. This language will expand VA's capacity to adjudicate appeals at no added cost, thereby expediting results and for waiting veterans and eliminating substantial travel costs to the veteran and the administration. It would also create priority processing for veterans 70 years old and older, those who have been awarded the Medal of Honor, those who have been victims of military sexual trauma, amongst others. Representative Paul Cook, fellow Californian and Marine Corps veteran, championed priority processing last Congress, and I look forward to working with him and my other colleagues on both sides of the aisle to see this bill become law. Finally, this amendment would include provisions from my bill, the Veterans Survivor Claims Processing Automation Act, that authorize the VA to initiate and pay survivor benefits without requiring a formal claim, as long as sufficient evidence exists on record to process survivors' benefits. This law should not force deceased veterans' loved ones to take time away from their family while grieving, file a formal claim, and wait months on end to access needed survivors' benefits the veterans have already earned. My bill would authorize the VA to initiate and pay survivor benefits without requiring a formal claim, as long as sufficient evidence exists on record to process survivors' benefits. These bills are practical, pragmatic, bipartisan solutions that will make a difference for veterans and their families, which is why it has the support of veterans in my district and VSOs who have testified at legislative hearings before this committee. I sincerely urge the members of this committee to come together again to advance these essential measures out of committee and to advocate for the speaker to bring it to the floor. I understand delaying controversial and contentious policy proposals until an agreement is forged, but denying veterans relief when a consensus has been reached is unacceptable. So I urge my colleagues to support these provisions and look forward to continue working with colleagues on both sides of the aisle, VSOs, and the veterans in my district to advance this legislation and show veterans the support that they have earned. So thank you, and I yield back my time.
Thank you very much. Any other discussion? Who seeks recognition for the purpose of offering an amendment?
We're on H.R.
677.
Mr. Chairman?
Ms. Titus.
Yes, I'll go. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have an amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute with the clerk.
The clerk shall report.
Amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 677, offered by Ms. Titus of Nevada.
I ask unanimous consent that further reading of the amendment be dispensed with in the nature of a substitute be dispensed with, and hearing no objections, so ordered. I recognize Ms. Titus for 5 minutes to discuss her amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate that. This morning, I'm offering just a very simple amendment to address outdated language that's found in Title 38 of the U.S. Code. It simply changes the definition of the word spouse, a word that's mentioned 6 times in this bill, to be generic instead of specifically referring to a man or a woman. Following the clear ruling by the Supreme Court of the United States in Obergefell versus Hodges, the VA has issued a statement regarding adjudication of VA benefits claims to same-sex couples. The VA has notified us that they are in the process of issuing guidance to respond to the court's decision in the coming weeks. Yet Title 38 of the U.S. Code still reflects decades-old language that does not meet the constitutional reality of today. Now, this committee over the years has updated the U.S. Code to modernize its language when that's been appropriate. In fact, in 1986, Congress passed the Veterans Benefits Improvement and Health Care Authorization Act that updated our laws to reflect that indeed we have women veterans, that not all service members are men and not all spouses are women. This amendment does simply the same thing. It's about recognition that the laws of the land should reflect the constitutional interpretation by the Supreme Court. Now, I know that some of my colleagues may disagree with the court's decision, and that's fine. That's their prerogative. That's their decision. But we're federal representatives with a responsibility here to ensure all our service members, all our veterans, all of their families have access to the benefits that they've earned and deserve. We owe it to those who wear the uniform, who have worn the uniform, and to their loved ones here at home to respect their service in both word and deed and to treat them all fairly and equally. So I would ask my colleagues to support this amendment and let us move forward to address the critical challenge that we as a committee have a responsibility to tackle, and that's providing the benefits and services that all our veterans have earned and deserve. I yield back.
Thank you very much, Ms. Titus. The amendment in the nature of the substitute, as everybody knows, includes many provisions that would provide concrete benefits for veterans, including improvements to VA's claims and appeals procedures, the automatic cost of living adjustment to ensure that veterans' benefits keep pace with inflation, the new projections for beneficiaries who are in the fiduciary program, honoring members of the Merchant Marine who served during World War II, and ensuring that our nation remembers and honors the service and sacrifice of deceased veterans and veterans that are disabled for life. Conversely, the gentlelady's amendment really has no practical benefit for our nation's veterans today. In fact, this amendment has the potential to do a great disservice by becoming a poison pill and endangering passage of H.R. 677. The intensity of the personal feelings about the gentlelady's amendment could result in this legislation actually becoming a lightning rod. It's very possible that if this amendment is adopted, members who would otherwise enthusiastically support this legislation with its many provisions to help veterans would be forced to vote against it. This committee does have a history of working together in a bipartisan manner because we have always focused on accomplishments rather than messaging and scoring points. The reality is that the gentlelady's amendment is essentially a conforming change to the law and could risk jeopardizing the bill with really no improvement for veterans and their families, particularly since the VA is already providing benefits that her amendment would formalize. So I urge my colleagues to oppose the amendment and ask if there's any other discussion on Ms. Titus's amendment, the nature of a substitute, not to H.R. 677. Mr. Takano.
Mr. Chairman, I want to congratulate my colleague, Ms. Titus, for bringing forward this amendment. I take exception to the notion that standing up for the principle of equality would do great harm and would serve as a lightning rod. I find it shameful that we talk about equality of all Americans in terms of that being a lightning rod issue. And with that said, I would yield more time to my colleague.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Takano, for leaving. I appreciate that. I support all of these extended benefits for our veterans. It's just that I support them for all our veterans, not just for some of our veterans. And as for the messaging and the need to make points, I don't think I need to make any points with this community that I'm trying to support. I appreciate your concern, but I would say to the members who have a hard time voting for this for personal or political reasons or to make points with their own constituencies, that you can do like the clerk in Kentucky did. If this is against your personal belief, just walk out of the room and don't vote. But don't vote no. Don't vote to say to some of our veterans, you don't deserve these same benefits. You think that this is a lightning rod? You look those veterans in the eye, those people who wore the uniform, those people who put their lives on the line so we could sit in this Congress and say to them, I'm sorry, you're a lightning rod. You don't get these benefits. We can't even change the law to reflect what the court has done, what states have done, what is the right thing to do. So if you can't vote for this, walk out of the room and just don't vote at all. Thank you. I yield back.
I thank the gentlelady. I would refer to my comment and said it could result, may result, in this becoming a lightning rod. Is there any further discussion on the amendment? Who else seeks recognition for the purpose of offering an amendment? Ms. Brown, do you have an amendment? Okay, very good. I would have supported your amendment, Ms. Brown, had you offered it. Too late. Too late. Since no other amendments have been timely filed, the question now occurs on Ms. Titus's amendment on the amendment in the nature of the substitute to H.R. 677. As previously discussed, I will not be supporting this. I will not be supporting this amendment. All those in favor of Ms. Titus's amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 677 will say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no.
No.
No. The noes have it. Ms. Titus's amendment, the nature of a substitute to H.R. 677, is not agreed to.
Chairman, I would ask for a roll call vote.
The clerk should call the roll.
On the amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 677 offered by Ms. Titus, Mr. Miller?
No.
Mr. Miller votes no. Mr. Lamborn? Mr. Lamborn votes no. Mr. Bilirakis?
No.
Mr. Bilirakis votes no. Dr. Rowe?
No.
Dr. Rowe votes no. Dr. Beneshek?
No.
Dr. Beneshek votes no. Mr. Hulskamp?
No.
Mr. Hulskamp votes no. Mr. Kaufman?
Yes.
Mr. Kaufman votes yes. Dr. Winstrup?
No.
Dr. Winstrup votes no. Ms. Walorski?
No.
Ms. Walorski votes no. Dr. Abraham?
No.
Dr. Abraham votes no. Mr. Zeldin?
No.
Mr. Zeldin votes no. Mr. Costello?
Yes.
Mr. Costello votes yes. Ms. Radawagen?
No.
Ms. Radawagen votes no. Mr. Boss?
No.
Mr. Boss votes no. Ms. Brown?
Present.
Ms. Brown votes present. Mr. Takano?
Yes.
Mr. Takano votes yes. Ms. Brownlee?
Yes.
Ms. Brownlee votes yes. Ms. Titus?
Yes.
Ms. Titus votes yes. Dr. Ruiz?
Yes.
Dr. Ruiz votes yes. Ms. Custer?
Yes.
Ms. Custer votes yes. Mr. O'Rourke?
Yes.
Mr. O'Rourke votes yes. Ms. Rice?
Yes.
Ms. Rice votes yes. Mr. Walsh?
Yes.
Mr. Walsh votes yes. Mr. McNerney? Mr. Chairman, the vote is 10 yay, 12 nay, 1 present, 1 absent.
And so the amendment fails. The question now occurs on Dr. Abraham's amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 677. All those in favor of Dr. Abraham's amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 677 as amended will say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed, no. The ayes have it. Dr. Abraham's amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 677 as amended is agreed to. Is there any more discussion on the bill as amended? Hearing none, the question now occurs on passage of H.R. 677 as amended. All those in favor will say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed will say no. The ayes have it. H.R. 677 as amended is agreed to. I now recognize Ranking Member Brown for a motion on reporting H.R. 677 as amended.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I move that H.R. 677 as amended be reported favorably to the House of Representatives.
Thank you very much, Ms. Brown. I know we've switched the scripts around just a little bit, and I appreciate that. All those in favor will say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed will say no. The opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. The motion is agreed to, and H.R. 677 as amended is reported favorably to the full House. I now call up H.R. 3106 as amended. The clerk shall report.
H.R. 3106 as amended, to authorize Department Major Medical Facility Construction Projects for fiscal year 2015 to amend Title 38 United States Code to make certain improvements in the administration of Department Medical Facility Construction Projects and for other purposes.
Without objection, the first reading is dispensed with, and the bill is now open for amendment at any point. And I have an amendment in the nature of a substitute. The desk and the clerk shall report.
Amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106 offered by Mr. Miller of Florida.
I ask unanimous consent that further reading of the amendment be dispensed with, as amended be dispensed with, hearing no objection, so ordered. And we're all familiar with the many deficiencies that VA's major medical facility construction program has been plagued with in recent years. Of course, the latest and most blatant example of VA's construction catastrophes is the replacement Denver VA Medical Center construction project that has been marked since the project's inception 15 years ago by failures, delays, and mismanagement that has culminated earlier this year in VA's admission that the project is more than $1 billion over budget. Clearly, there are very serious problems with VA's construction management oversight process, and clearly serious reforms are needed. My amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106 as amended would put many of those reforms in place and help assure our veterans and our taxpayers that this committee and this Congress will no longer allow their time and their money to be wasted by incompetent VA construction officials. First, it would require VA to enter into an agreement with a non-VA entity like the Army Corps of Engineers to provide project management services for what will be determined super construction projects or those involving a total expenditure of more than $100 million. VA would be prohibited from obligating or expending funds for any advanced planning or design for any super construction project, from obligating funds for a major medical facility or super construction project by more than 10% of the amount that's been approved by law, and from using bid savings amounts or funds for other than their original purpose without first seeking congressional approval. Secondly, my amendment in the nature of a substitute would require VA to use the greatest extent possible industry standards, standard designs, and best practices for all VA medical facility construction projects to strengthen the training that VA construction employees receive, to complete a master plan for each VA medical center facility, to put guidelines in place for the handling of change orders, and to report regularly on the use of bid savings and on the status of all super construction projects. It would also authorize VA to construct a new bed tower at the VA Medical Center in Tampa and authorize major construction projects at Canandaigua, Long Beach, San Francisco, West Los Angeles, and San Diego, and would authorize appropriations for these projects. Finally, my amendment in the nature of a substitute would create within VA's Office of the Inspector General an Assistant Inspector General for Construction who has expertise in construction and facilities management and who will be responsible for conducting, supervising, and coordinating audits, evaluations, and investigations into the planning, design, contracting, execution, and construction of VA facilities and infrastructure. According to the Congressional Budget Office, there is a discretionary score of $6 million associated with this legislation, which I would fully offset before any possible floor consideration. Is there any discussion on my amendment in the nature of a substitute? Mr. Kaufman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think that the Chairman's proposal will go a long way in terms of cleaning up the construction management practices of the VA. I wish the number were lower, but I understand the art of compromise and that we certainly will be watching the VA in terms of if a $100 million project becomes a $200 million project, becomes a $300 million project, then that number certainly can go lower in the future. But they've certainly demonstrated that they cannot do construction management, and it's not their core responsibility. It's delivering health care and the benefits that the men and women who serve this country in defense of our freedom have earned, and it is not, as they have demonstrated, being a construction management entity. And so I thank the Chairman for his work in this and certainly encourage my colleagues to vote for it.
Any other comments? Who seeks recognition for the purpose of offering an amendment?
Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Brown.
I have an amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106.
The clerk shall report.
Amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106, offered by Ms. Brown of Florida.
I ask unanimous consent that further reading of the amendment in the nature to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106, as amended, be dispensed with, and hearing no objections, so ordered. I now recognize the ranking member, Ms. Brown, for discussion on her amendment.
Mr. Chairman, my amendment would add an additional requirement regarding a construction project level of complexity in order for that project to come under the definition of a super construction project and trigger the involvement of a non-VA entity to manage that project. I believe my amendment better would align the needs of the outside project managers to make sure that the VA construction projects come on in time and on budget while not adding unnecessary responsibility to this outside project manager. A simple project, even if it's over $100 million threshold, may not require this expertise. A complex project most probably does. The VA has been out of construction business for a long time, really over 15 years. I believe that many of these reforms we're considering today are necessary in order to get these important projects built. I believe my amendment adds an important consideration to the reform efforts. I urge my colleagues to support this amendment, and I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you very much. Any other discussion on Ms. Brown's amendment? I appreciate her bringing this amendment to the floor, but I think given the magnitude of the problems we have seen in VA's management of major construction projects and the reluctance that many on this dais have expressed when discussing whether or not VA should be allowed to manage any construction projects at all, I don't think that providing the VA with the latitude to determine whether or not a facility is complex enough to warrant the super construction project designation is really appropriate. So I'm not going to support Ms. Brown's amendment to the amendment in the nature of the substitute to H.R. 3106 as amended, and would ask now, is there any further discussion on the ranking member's amendment? Who else seeks recognition in the for the purpose of offering amendment?
Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Brownlee.
I have an amendment at the desk.
Clerk shall report Ms. Brownlee's amendment.
Amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106, offered by Ms. Brownlee of California.
I ask unanimous consent that further reading of Ms. Brownlee's amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute, H.R. 3106, as amended, be dispensed with. And I recognize Ms. Brownlee, hearing no objections to order, so I recognize Ms. Brownlee for discussion on her amendment.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. As repeated delays and cost overruns in Denver, Orlando, Las Vegas, and New Orleans have made clear, the VA struggles to plan and manage some of their construction projects. This problem has cost the government billions of dollars and threatens veterans' access to life-saving care. My amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106 would improve congressional oversight on the VA construction program. Specifically, it would direct the Assistant Inspector General for Construction to make quarterly reports to our committee on its activities. It would also direct the Assistant Inspector General for Construction to provide the findings of any investigation it undertakes to the committee. Finally, it would require that the Assistant Inspector General for Construction promptly notify the committee if any serious problems relating to the administration or the operation of any VA construction project is found in the course of an investigation that the Assistant Inspector General determines requires immediate action by Congress. Mr. Chairman, I agree that oversight of VA construction is critical, and I appreciate the language you have added in Section 5. I ask that my colleagues support my amendment to further improve our committee's ability to oversee the VA's construction program. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I yield back.
Thank you very much, Ms. Brownlee. And again, I appreciate the intent of the amendment, though I do have a concern about the provision that would require the new Assistant Inspector General for Construction to notify Congress if he or she determines that Congress should take immediate action on a given issue. Determining what really warrants a congressional action and when that action should occur is not the role of the Inspector General, as the Inspector General has no jurisdiction in determining the oversight actions of Congress. So suffice it to say that it was Congress's oversight that spurred any IG review of the disaster that is the Denver Replacement Hospital Project. I'm going to be supporting this amendment, but I would like to ask Ms. Brownlee if you would work with us before this bill is taken to the floor to clarify, because there are some issues that we do have a little bit of concern with, but I will support the amendment. Any further discussion? Hearing none, who else seeks recognition for the purpose of offering amendment?
Mr. Chairman, I have an amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106.
The clerk shall report.
Amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106, offered by Ms. Rice of New York.
I ask unanimous consent that further reading of Ms. Rice's amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106 as amended be dispensed with, and hearing no objections, so ordered. Ms. Rice, you're recognized for 5 minutes to discuss your amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, my amendment to the ANS would require an external third-party entity to conduct a forensic audit of the VA Medical Center construction project in Aurora, Colorado. My amendment would further require an external forensic audit on any major medical facility or super construction project for which expenses exceed the amount authorized by law by more than 25%. The Aurora facility has been a case in point for why such audits are necessary. It started out with a total estimated cost of around $330 million and an estimated completion date of February 2014. 2 years later, it was $600 million. 2 years after that, $800 million. Now it stands at $1.7 billion. In 2 weeks, we're going to be again asked to allocate more money for this project, and we still don't know where all the rest has gone. We've heard a lot of excuses, but we need to see some real details. We need to know how every dollar was spent, what led to these cost overruns, and most importantly, who should be held accountable. We owe it to taxpayers, and above all else, we owe it to our veterans to ensure that every dollar the VA spends is spent serving the men and women who have served our country. I urge my colleagues to support my amendment so that we can find out exactly what happened at Aurora and prevent such debacles in the future. Mr. Chairman, I want to thank you for your leadership in taking up construction reform within the VA, and I look forward to continuing working together on this important issue. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I yield back.
Thank you very much, Ms. Rice. Any further discussion on Ms. Rice's amendment? Mr. Kaufman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I rise in support of the Rice Amendment. I think it's very important that we have a third-party investigation to get down to the bottom in terms of accountability and whether or not to make that final determination as whether there was criminal conduct involved in the cost overruns in the Aurora project and the other projects as well. There were hundreds of millions of dollars over budget each in accordance with the April 2003 GAO report. Just a point of clarification, the starting point is $604 million as a standalone facility. The previous number of, I think, $300-something million was as a joint facility, which was abandoned in standalone facility. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you very much. Any further discussion?
I have a question for Mr.
Kaufman. Ms. Brown has a question for Mr. Kaufman.
Mr. Kaufman,
we've had lengthy discussions about this project, and you know the history of this project,
sure,
more than any other member on this,
right,
committee. Mm-hmm. Have you provided that information to all of the members? Because this project started out totally different from what it ended up. It started out as a joint project, I think, with the university, and just the history. And I'm just wondering how much this is going to cost.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Kaufman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think it would be good to go back with the history. It was before I was in Congress, but when it was a joint facility, several administrations ago, and how that was turned down in favor of a standalone facility. Now, that doesn't change the dynamics of what Ms. Rice is asking, because the standalone facility was still estimated at $604 million, and now we're at $1.7 billion. And so it's how on earth did it get to that point? And the fact is that it was public knowledge, really, in April of 2003 when this committee received a GAO report that talked about the Aurora project being out of control in terms of cost, as well as three other projects. But we didn't know until recently, I mean, the extraordinary number when the Army Corps of Engineers stepped in and came up with this $1.7 billion number. I think we have to obviously do the forensic work to find out how we got to this point, but we also need to pass the necessary reforms, which I think we're doing today in part, to make sure this never happens again. I yield back.
Ms. Brown, I have a complete synopsis of the Denver funding issue, and I will make it available to all committee members so that they will have a perspective that may be a little deeper than the knowledge that they may have, and understand that we are going to be dealing with this issue again within the next couple of weeks, because the funding bridge that we provided to the VA to continue construction at the hospital will expire. They will now be asking for another $625 million. That is going to have to be authorized. The cap will need to be raised again, and the offset will have to be brought before this committee. And I will say that I am not at all happy with the offsets that the VA has provided. I believe that they're not true offsets. I'd be happy to discuss it with you. I think that this project is one that requires more scrutiny. And bear in mind, again, the offsets that the VA provided to us were on half a page of paper. This requires a little more seriousness than that. And so we will be discussing this issue again. Ms. Brown, do you have another comment?
No, sir. I not disagreeing with you, but I guess I'm a little uncomfortable even calling this a Denver project because it's a regional project. And but it, I mean, and so we keep saying Denver, but it's going to serve, Mr. Crawford, not just Denver, but what are the other areas? Because it's not just one area that it's going to serve.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's a regional facility. I believe it's about a four-state area.
Sir, what are those four states?
Oh. Colorado, with Kansas, New Mexico, I believe Wyoming.
At $1.7 billion, it should serve the entire nation. Thank you very much, Ms. Brown.
Mr. Chairman, I want to know if a veteran from Florida go to Denver, they will be able to be served.
I hope they can. I sure do. Who else seeks recognition for the purpose of offering an amendment? Mr. McNerney?
Yes, sir.
Do you have an amendment?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I have an amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute at the desk.
Clerk shall report.
Amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106, offered by Mr. McNerney of California.
To H.R. 3106, as amended, be dispensed with. Hearing no objections, so ordered, and I recognize Mr. McNerney for 5 minutes to discuss his amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My amendment is designed to help reduce the VA construction backlog by creating public-private partnerships at the VA. This amendment authorizes the Secretary to enter into partnership agreements with non-departmental federal agencies such as the Corps of Engineers and non-federal entities for the construction of major projects authorized by law. It also allows organizations outside the VA to serve as project managers for major construction projects and permits the VA to match half of the funds for authorized major construction projects. My amendment would permit state and local governments to partner with private entities for the construction of VA medical facilities. State and local agencies could bid out the contracts to private companies to start the construction of the major medical facilities and accelerate the backlog of construction projects. We've seen the benefits of public-private partnerships throughout the government, in transportation, in water, electric grid, infrastructure, and our healthcare system. The VA's construction backlog would take 67 years of funding levels to be caught up, at current funding levels to be caught up. Veterans in my district have waited more than a decade for a new facility. For my district, it takes 4 hours a one-way trip to the nearest VA hospital. We need to do more on this issue. My amendment aims to build off the reforms by Chairman Miller to ensure that the VA medical facility construction process is prepared for the years ahead. With that, Mr. Chairman, I withdraw my amendment.
Thank you very much, Mr. McNerney. Again, I was prepared to support your amendment. You guys are...
Well, it wasn't any funny.
You guys are always withdrawing the ones I want to support. Since no other timely amendments were filed, the question now occurs on the ranking member, Ms. Brown's amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R.
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to withdraw my amendment, but let me just say that before this bill comes to the floor, I would like for you to commit that you will work with me on the provisions of, there are several provisions in this bill that I would like to discuss prior to this bill coming to the floor.
Absolutely, and I think we'll have to do that in the very near future, because I hope that this bill does make it to the floor very quickly, and I do give you my word that we will have an opportunity to discuss. So hearing no objection, Ms. Brown's amendment has been withdrawn. The question now occurs on Ms. Brownlee's amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106 as amended. As previously discussed, I am going to support the amendment. I'll be working with Ms. Brownlee prior to floor consideration of the legislation to clarify the requirement that the new Assistant Inspector General for Construction be required to notify the Congress of an issue that the Inspector General determines warrants immediate congressional action. And that said, I would ask that all members in favor of Ms. Brownlee's amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106 as amended say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. The ayes have it. Ms. Brownlee's amendment, the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106 as amended, is agreed to. The question now occurs on Ms. Rice's amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106 as amended. As I have previously stated, I will be supporting this amendment, so I would ask that all those in favor of Ms. Rice's amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute, H.R. 3106 as amended, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, say no. The ayes have it. Ms. Rice's amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106 as amended is agreed to, and the question now occurs on Mr. McNerney's. He withdrew his amendment. Again, as I told you, Mr. McNerney, I would have supported your amendment, but the question now occurs on my amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106 as amended. All those in favor of the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106 as amended, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3106 as amended is agreed to. Is there any more discussion on the bill as amended? The question now occurs on the passage of H.R. 3106 as amended. All those in favor will say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, no. The ayes have it. H.R. 3106 as amended is agreed to, and I recognize the ranking member, Ms. Brown, for a motion on reporting H.R. 3106 as amended.
Mr. Chairman, I move that H.R. 3106 as amended be reported favorably to the House of Representatives.
All those in favor will say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. The ayes have it. The motion is agreed to. H.R. 3106 as amended is favorably reported to the full House. I now call up H.R. 3016. The clerk shall report.
H.R. 3016, to amend Title 38 United States Code to clarify the role of podiatrists in the Department of Veterans Affairs.
The bill has been circulated in advance pursuant to committee rules. Without objection, the first reading is dispensed with. The bill is open for amendment at any point. Who seeks recognition for the purpose of offering an amendment?
Mr. Chairman, I have an amendment in the nature of a substitute.
Dr. Winstrom.
3016 at the desk.
The clerk shall report.
Amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3016 offered by Mr. Winstrup of Ohio.
I ask unanimous consent that further reading of the amendment in the nature of a substitute be dispensed with. Hearing no objection, so ordered. I recognize Dr. Winstrup for 5 minutes to discuss his amendment in the nature of a substitute.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3016 includes many provisions from bills that I have introduced, as well as bills introduced by members of this committee and our other colleagues relating to veterans' health care and education and employment programs. Due to the vast amount of provisions including in this ANS, I will briefly touch on all of the language that is included. This ANS includes the text of my original bill, H.R. 3016, which would redefine VA's definition of physicians to include podiatrists and would require podiatrists to be viewed equal to other medical doctors at the department. It also includes language from several other health-related bills introduced by our colleagues that would make improvements to newborn care, increase priority care for Medal of Honor recipients, initiate a pilot program to assess the effectiveness of the use of service dog therapy for veterans suffering with mental health symptoms and PTSD, increase outreach to veterans with credit issues related to delay of payments from VA to non-VA providers, and require GAO to conduct periodic audits of VA's health care budget. My ANS to H.R. 3016 also includes many provisions relating to veterans' education and employment programs as well. It includes provisions from H.R. 475 as amended, which was favorably reported out of this committee earlier this year, as well as other bills that have been favorably reported out of the Subcommittee on Economic Opportunity. These provisions include language related to sensible cap on GI Bill funds for flight training, improvements to IT programs for GI Bill processing, language originally introduced by Mr. Takano to allow certain reservists and National Guardsmen who are wounded or injured while on active duty to receive post-9/11 GI Bill benefits, which many are currently not eligible for, language that was introduced by Representative Calvert and Representative Takano, which deals with centralized reporting of GI Bill eligibility for schools. Language introduced by Vice Chairman Bill Arrakis requiring VA to conduct a survey of GI Bill participants. Language introduced by Representative Zeldin, which eliminates the maximum loan guarantee amount for VA-backed home loans. Language that was introduced by Representative Kuhlskamp, which looks at protecting veteran-owned and service-disabled veteran-owned small businesses. And language introduced by our colleague Representative Duckworth, which makes important changes to Frye scholarship language that was included in the Choice Act last year so that spouses have a greater amount of time to use these education benefits that was expanded to them last summer. Changes to the service requirement for service members to be eligible to transfer their GI Bill benefits would also be changed in this ANS, so service members would now be required to serve 10 years and sign up for additional 2 years instead of the current mandate of 6-year requirement with an additional 4 years. The housing allowance for children receiving their parents' GI Bill benefits would also be reduced by half. These both were recommendations from the Military Pay Commission earlier this year, and they, in fact, recommended reducing the housing allowance for all transferees, but we believe it is important to maintain the full benefits for spouses, as I agree with many of the VSOs that often they are the primary caregivers of the family and need the full monthly stipend. Language from my bill, H.R. 2344, to make changes to the VA administrations of voc rehab is also included in the ANS to H.R. 3016, which I believe will lessen counselors' workloads and allow for better prioritization of services for our wounded veterans who need them most. Finally, my ANS also includes language from Chairman Miller's bill, H.R. 2275, that was reported favorably out of my subcommittee in June, which would create a fourth administration at VA entitled Veterans Economic Opportunity and Transition Administration, and would also transfer all programs and functions of the Veterans Employment and Training Service out of the Department of Labor and into this new administration. As I said at the subcommittee level, I fully support this provision. I think it's important to bring more of a focus to these vital programs for our veterans. There are well over 30 different bills and provisions included in this ANS to enhance education and employment services and improve the health care that our veterans and service members receive. I thank our colleagues for bringing forth so many great ideas, and I believe these are all our common sense reforms and provisions and will bring about needed positive change for our active duty service members, veterans, and their families. And I yield back.
Thank you very much, Dr. Winstrup. If you don't withdraw your amendment, I will support it.
I will not withdraw.
Any other discussion on the amendment in the nature of a substitute? Who else seeks recognition for the purposes of offering amendment?
Mr. Chairman.
Dr. Rowe.
Thank you. I have an amendment to the amendment nature of substitutes. Very simple amendment. If you get maternity services
the
at
clerk,
a VA...
clerk shall report. Okay.
Amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3016, offered by Mr. Rowe of Tennessee.
I ask unanimous consent that further reading of the amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute be dispensed with and hearing no objections so ordered. I recognize Dr. Rowe now for 5 minutes for his amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute.
All my amendment does, Mr. Chairman, is in line with what good obstetrical care is. If a woman gets her care through the VA, her baby should also have care. And instead of 14 days, it should be 42 days. We just simply put 6 weeks checkup, as any obstetrician does in the country, and that's all this is. And I would certainly appreciate your support for this. And I yield back.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rowe. I am going to support the amendment, although I would note that CBO has scored this at $118 million over 5 years. So before this legislation can move to the floor, the cost is going to need to be paid for, and I look forward to working with Dr. Rowe and anybody that would be willing to help find the necessary offsites for this very important piece of legislation. This amendment will work together to identify those dollars.
Mr. Chairman, could I speak to that for a second?
Yes, sir, Dr. Rowe.
You know, I think, and this is one of the things that we make bad decisions based on what a CBO score is. If you had scored, we discussed and debated the 21st Century Cures Bill, we would have scored the treatment of polio as a cost. And I don't see how in the world having a checkup at 6 weeks as opposed to 2 weeks is going to, I don't know how they came up with that number. Now, we're going to have to come up with some gimmick here, which is, I hope we don't do anything too gimmicky, but to find a cost here makes no sense to me whatsoever. It's just as, if you just think about common sense, a mother brings her baby in at 6 weeks instead of, how could that cost more money? Most obstetrical care is global. It's not, it's in other words, when I take on a patient in my office, there's a global fee that covers a 6 week checkup. It adds nothing to the cost. So I yield back.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rowe. I would point out that we do not do gimmicks here. You know that. We find real offsets. And unfortunately, we're bound by the rules that require, whether we want to move it forward or not. The same held true when we were dealing with the Choice Act last year, and we wanted to give health care to every veteran in the country. And CBO scored that as a $50 billion cost, not taking into effect that when you take it in the outside, you're actually decreasing the cost on the inside, and so they would not bring those numbers together. I understand your frustration. I think you're going to see widespread support from this committee, and we'll work together to try to find the appropriate offset, not gimmick. Is there any other discussion on the amendment and the amendment in the nature of substitute?
I have
yes.
a question for
Ms. Brown.
I have a question for Mr. Rowe, Congressman. At our hearing, I think Congresswoman Duffer talked about the VA paying timely for this service, and if it's not, it messes with the veteran's credit. And did we can we take a look at that provision, because that came out during our hearing?
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. So in addition to providing the service, if they don't pay, then it affects the veterans, you know, when they're delivering the baby and they use the outside service and or use the, whatever, they did not pay. And that came out during our hearing when we were talking about that area.
Well, we're either going to pay for veterans' health care or we're not. And I think it's frustrating to me when if it's an outside service. And I always say that one of the reasons we took care of pregnant patients is one of those is or you ain't things. It's not a am I maybe pregnant. You absolutely are. And we're going to provide the care, and we ought to pay for the care. And we ought to provide it in timely and consistent with what the standard of care is around the country.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. I yield back.
Ms. Brown, I think that's an outstanding point to bring up. I think we all heard during the month of August the lack of timeliness of payments from the VA. In fact, I heard where there were doctors that were absolutely stopping, which is harming the Choice program because they're not getting paid in a timely fashion. And so we have to talk to VA and see if they can, in fact, again, in the 21st century, if you authorize the care, you should be able to make the payment in a timely fashion. Who else seeks recognition of the purpose of offering an amendment?
I'd like to comment on Dr. Rowe's comments.
Thank
you, Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member. I agree with my fellow physician and the frustration in utilizing a CBO as a precise science, because it is not. It is the best estimate based on assumptions by economists who oftentimes are far removed from the science of public health and medicine. And one of the things that we know are that these assumptions do not account for the cost savings that certain laws provide due to better health, due to continuity of care in this regards that may exist. And therefore, I caution my colleagues in using these assumptions and estimates as some form of precise science. And I look forward to the ability to help get this through through the floor.
Thank you very much. Any further discussion? Mr. Cano.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have an amendment at the desk.
The clerk shall report Mr. Takano's amendment.
Amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3016, offered by Mr. Takano of California to strike section 301.
Ms. Members, I ask unanimous consent that further reading of the amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute be dispensed with, and hearing no objections, so ordered. Mr. Takano is now recognized for 5 minutes to discuss his amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I first want to thank you for including two important bills in the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3016, my work study for Student Veterans Act and Representative Maloney's Wounded Warrior Employment Improvement Act. I also appreciate the inclusion of provisions from H.R. 475, including my GI Bill Fairness Act to ensure that wounded service members accrue VA education benefits while receiving medical care. And I want to thank Dr. Wenstrup, and his staff for working with me to improve these bills as they move through the Economic Opportunity Subcommittee. Thank you, Mr. Weintraub. And at this time, I'd like to offer an amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute. My amendment removes the section of the amendment in the nature of a substitute which would change transferability requirements for post-9/11 GI Bill benefits. Currently, service members who have served for 6 years can elect to transfer their education benefits to a spouse or dependent if they commit to serving 4 more years. The amendment in the nature of substitute to H.R. 3016 would change this rule, requiring service members to serve 10 years and commit 2 more in order to transfer these valuable benefits. In addition, transferees currently receive the full living expense stipend to ensure that they're able to make the fullest use of the education benefits. The ANS would cut the available stipend in half for those dependents receiving transferred benefits. The changes in this provision exist largely to save money, not to meet the educational needs of veterans or their dependents. What's more, these changes would go back on the promises we made to service members when they first joined our nation's military. And given that the Defense Department relies on transferability as a recruitment and retention tool, I believe these changes would be better raised in the House Armed Services Committee. I urge support for my amendment, and I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Takano, and I unfortunately cannot support this particular amendment, although, as you have already noted, I did include in the base legislation some of the legislation that you have proposed, but I would ask if there's any other discussion on the amendment to the amendment.
Mr. Chairman.
Dr. Weintraub first, and
correct.
We'll go to you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank Mr. Takano for his amendment and for all the hard work he does as ranking member of the Economic Opportunity Subcommittee. But this time I must oppose its adoption. While I appreciate his concerns about the changes we're making to the transferee requirements of the post-9/11 GI Bill, it's important to note that I'm not proposing this change in a vacuum. And currently, this section is based on recommendations of the Military Compensation and Retirement Modernization Commission, which released their final report earlier this year. As many of you know, the commission was chartered by Congress to study all compensation and benefits for service members and veterans. The commissioners are all highly qualified individuals with years of experience in both defense and veterans policy, and were chosen on a bipartisan basis. They conducted an exhaustive study of pay and retirement programs and interviewed and surveyed service members for their study. In the final report, they recommended that Congress modify the existing requirement for a service member to be eligible to transfer their GI Bill benefits to a dependent from 6 years of active duty service with an additional 4-year commitment to 10 years of active duty service with an additional 2-year commitment. They found that this change would strengthen retention compared to the current eligibility requirements. The Commission also found that in many cases, the housing allowance currently provided to transferee children often exceeds by thousands of dollars the cost of room and board at the schools that the children attend. While the Commission recommended ending all housing allowance payments to both transferee spouses and children, my amendment would only reduce the housing allowance for children by half of the current amount and would leave the housing allowance provided to spouses untouched. Several veteran service organizations expressed support for this change, and while I understand that DOD would like more time to study this recommendation, I would say that the Commission has also studied this exhaustively and no further study is needed. The amendment also provides a grandfather clause, so current transferees would not be impacted by this amendment. So this would be in place for all those joining the service that know what the rules are going in. It doesn't change it for those that came in under the other rules. Finally, I would remind my colleagues that this section is a reasonable offset and is essentially paying for many other bipartisan and worthwhile provisions in this ANS, including two authored by Ranking Member Takano. If we vote to strip out this section, we'll be voting to essentially kill the bill, since no other offsets have been proposed at this time. So I urge all members to vote no on this amendment, and I yield back.
Mr. Waltz.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your work. And I'm supporting Mr. Tucano's, but Mr. Wenstrup, what he said, very thoughtful. And I know he knows this issue well from the MCRMC report, the Military Compensation and Retirement Modernization. Those of us on Armed Services spent countless time on this. He also is very aware of my position on this. Again, I don't disagree with what my colleague said, and I think there are smart things in here. Going to the 10 years, it's smart. The two additional years is already there. And I do think this is actually one that will have a positive impact on retention. But the reason I think Mr. Tucano's suggestion is right, this is a complex issue. It has been studied for years. There is not agreement on this. Military Officers Association is vehemently disapproves of what the results were on this. I don't deny what they were trying to do. Their charter for the MCRMC report was not to find cost savings. It was modernization. So the questions you need to ask is there an issue with the all-volunteer force? Is recruiting and retention being impacted? And what is the long-term impact of the decisions we make? I was under and still believe that we do not have answers to that. I do not deny the difficulty of trying to find offsets. I would suggest to all of you, I've asked this question and put the bill up for 10 years. Why don't we audit the Pentagon and see if perhaps there's a dime or two laying around before we come to the retirement or the benefits? And keep in line, the reason I feel so strongly about this issue is this is a red line issue for me because it was a benefit that was promised. If my ninth grader that I'm planning on sending to college in 4 years was under the assumption I'm going to use this or it was going forward, we start to run into some of these issues. So I want to be very clear about this. This is great stuff that's in here. We're trying to tackle this in the right way. We're caught in a conundrum on the offset. I would argue Mr. Tucano's point about this is the Pentagon has been unwilling, and I vote for Pentagon spending. I don't want to be a hypocrite here. I just simply don't know where they're spending all the money, and my concern is that we keep asking soldiers to pull from the left pocket to pull in the right pocket. We keep asking to make, and the commission report also did some smart things on long-term retirement, but to pay for 401k for those who don't do 20 years, guess where the money came from? Those doing 20 years. And so I'm going to support this amendment. I think there's more to be thought here. I think it's, for me, I don't want it to be that red line breach of trust issue. I want to acknowledge the incredible amount of hard work that went into reaching this. This discussion went on till 4 a.m. in Armed Services and voted, and Mr. Wenstrup is right. The vast majority of members of Armed Services supported the changes in many of these cases. I think now, though, when we inherit this issue, we inherit it in the VA, a little more study needs to be done. With that, I yield my 2 minutes back to my friend, Mr. Wenstrup.
Thank you, Mr. Walls. I appreciate that. One, the American Legion does support these changes, and you're grandfathered in, not to make you a grandfather already, but you are grandfathered in for your child if you already qualify with the 6 and 4. So we're not really breaking trust with anybody with these changes.
Could I ask, Mr. Winstrup, is it right, though, if with the 180 days in there that it's possible that if I was eligible for this with 5 years that I will go off again and then pick it back up? Am I interpreting that correctly?
I'd have to defer.
There's a window. It does create a hole, am I right? This is a donut hole for those of, if we remember the donut hole thing. I thought we created a donut hole here that will. Incorrect?
Let's let Mr. Clark respond.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The legislation requires that it pauses any election for 6 months. So if you make an election to provide the transferee benefit to your children or your spouse, 6 months after enactment, this requirement would be in effect. So if you have not met the service requirement before that time frame, you would not.
So a young troop.
I'm sorry, sir?
Potentially a young soldier.
A young soldier would potentially be in that situation, yes.
Is there a fix to that? Because this is a red line. This is a benefit promised and then pulled back after you signed up. And it may be a small number, but it's a pretty important red line. So I don't know if there's a fix to that, but I appreciate that interpretation. And
I appreciate that concern. That may be something we have to address. I appreciate the concern. It's very legitimate.
Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Brown.
Yeah,
Mr. Chairman, I've got to tell you, I've heard from lots of constituents on this particular issue, and I'm definitely supportive of the change that Mr. Congressman is trying to make. But I really think this is one bill that we need to discuss before it goes to the floor, because I've heard from many constituents that are not happy with this change in provision from, 4 years to 10 years and an additional two. And this is a policy committee, and for us to get into the in-depth offset, how we're going to pay for it, that's Ways and Means, the last time I discussed. It's whether or not it's a good policy idea, and I think from going from four to 10 is not a good idea. And from what I can hear from the constituents, they're not happy with this. And the groups that have contacted me and discussed this provision, not happy. And basically, why is it that we want to encourage them, but to talk about housing and how much the housing costs and the different provisions that we're talking about, once we make a promise to the soldiers, we need to keep that promise.
Thank you very much, Ms. Brown. Mr. Takano.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I just would echo the sentiments of the ranking member, and just I hope we, Dr. Winstrup, we can examine how this impacts certain groups of service members more carefully to the extent we can before it finally does go to the floor.
And I'm willing to have those discussions.
May I ask a question?
Dr. Beneshek.
I guess I didn't quite get the result of the conversation between Mr. Walls and the staff people there. I mean, so there are people that you say that will be affected that are already in now? Is that
correct. And it's an anomaly in there on what the requirements were asking. It could happen to a young troop. And I think the argument could be made is what young troop has a college dependent in there. So there's fairness in that. It's as much about the commitment and not violating this, because there's a lot of angst around this Mickermick report, even though there's some hard decisions being made, and that's what we're elected to do. I agree with that, and some things that need to be changed, but there's a feeling amongst troops that you promised us benefits and you're taking them away. And this was the one in that discussion that was clearly one of those. None of these others, if you're in today, all their other suggestions and things they put forward are your grandfathered. This was the one that had a reach back in it, and that's why I'm a little I'm very concerned till we clarify that.
I guess my question is, it wasn't your intention that there be this in this amendment, is that right? I mean, I'm just trying to get the gist of all this.
The intention is for people to be grandfathered into what they came into the service with.
So, can we just make that happen if we pass the amendment?
Let us do this.
It's a pay-for issue.
I think, right now there is a about a $770 million delta out there that we've got to look at. Again, this is another one that I think we all know what the intention is. And Mr. Waltz, thank you for bringing this again. I was in the discussion at 4 o'clock in the morning also in the Armed Services markup. We do not want to penalize anybody that, in fact, the promise has been made to. So let's do this. Let's agree to continue to work before this thing is actually brought to the floor. And Mr. Takano, do you have another? Clerk shall report Mr. Takano's amendment.
Amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3016, offered by Mr. Takano of California.
Dispensed with, hearing no objections, so ordered. Mr. Takano is now recognized for 5 minutes in support of his amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Advisory Committee on Minority Veterans was set up in 1994 to ensure that VA policies adequately serve the interests of minority veterans. The committee was originally made up of recognized experts on Black, Latino, Native American, and Pacific Islander American veterans' needs, and in 2010, Congress added post-9/11 women veterans to this list. My amendment would expand the membership of the Advisory Committee on Minority Veterans to include veterans who are lesbian, gay, bisexual, and veterans who are transgender. Our laws and public attitudes toward LGBT individuals are rapidly changing for the better. The Supreme Court's recent ruling in favor of same-sex marriage extended marriage equality to couples in all 50 states and the territories. Our military no longer abides by the ineffective and unfair don't ask, don't tell policy. And this past July, Defense Secretary Carter issued a statement directing DOD to study the policy and readiness implications of welcoming transgender persons to serve openly in the military. Now, based on this decision, we can expect that VA will serve openly transgender veterans in the not-too-distant future. Expanding the Advisory Committee on Minority Veterans to include LGBT members is a chance to help VA anticipate the needs of its minority veterans before they arise, instead of waiting to react to the next crisis. Clearly, Secretary Carter has taken this approach in setting DOD policy with regard to active duty LGBT service members. Now, I want to recognize the efforts of our colleague, Representative Susan DelBene, who introduced a bill with the same intent as this amendment, which enjoys the support of many of us on this committee. I also want to thank Representative Titus for her efforts on this committee to ensure that our veterans with same-sex spouses receive their fair share of the VA benefits they have earned. I ask my colleagues to support LGBT representation to the Advisory Committee as a way to proactively plan for the needs of our veterans. Thank you, and I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Takano. As you have already outlined, Title 38 United States Code, Section 544 limits the focus on the Advisory Committee of Minority Veterans to veterans who are members of racial minority groups, specifically veterans who are Asian American, African American, Hispanic, Native American, or Pacific Islander American. Congress established the ACMV to provide advice to the Secretary with respect to veterans who may have unique needs because they belong to a specific racial group. This amendment would also duplicate the current efforts of the VA Office of Diversity and Inclusion, which is already focusing on substantial resources to LGBT outreach efforts. According to its website, VA has formed an LGBT work group and has set up a web page devoted to LGBT issues. Furthermore, VA also requires employees, managers, and supervisors to participate in training sessions which address cultural awareness, cultural competency, including LGBT issues. VA Central Office has even held LGBT Pride events. Finally, I want to point out that the Secretary already has the authority to appoint individuals from the LGBT community to the ACMV. As long as they are members of a minority racial group already served by the committee. The gentleman's amendment is really unnecessary, and I urge my colleagues to oppose it. But ask if there's any other discussion on the amendment in the nature of the substitute. Hearing none, who else seeks recognition for the purpose of offering an amendment? Ms. Titus?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have an amendment at the desk.
Clerk shall report.
Amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3016, offered by Ms. Titus of Nevada.
I ask unanimous consent that further reading of the amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute be dispensed with. Hearing no objections, so ordered. Ms. Titus, you are recognized for 5 minutes for your amendment in the nature of a substitute.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My amendment strikes Section 203 of the ANS and instead requires that studies be conducted in order to carefully evaluate this issue before Congress starts reorganizing the executive branch against its will. I say let's just be smart smart about this. Let's understand what we're doing before we run willy-nilly in this direction. The first part of the study would require the Department of Labor to examine its veterans' employment and training programs and include an analysis of how local communities benefit when employees of job placement programs are familiar with the intricacies of the local employment market. Second part would be conducted by the VA to investigate how many new employees would be needed if a separate administration is established within that agency. Finally, we would require the GAO to examine any overlap of functions of the Disabled Veterans Outreach Program and local veterans employment representatives at DOL to see what kind of duplication or replication would be occurring. These studies would allow Congress to better understand how these two departments use their various programs to best serve our veterans looking for job training and employment. As currently written, Section 203 of the ANS contains just a bold outline of this reorganization, but provides no concrete plans or how it would be facilitated. Just yesterday, we received a letter from VA Secretary Bob McDonnell and Labor Secretary Tom Perez. In this letter, they explain why moving the VA's Employment and Training Service, VETS is the acronym, would undermine the progress that's been made recently to help veterans get good paying jobs once they move into civilian life. They explain that in these letters the different roles and expertise that both the DOL and the VA bring to the effort. I'd like to share one critical quote from the letter. Rather than consolidating government programs, the proposal before the committee separates veterans' job training, job search, and job placement services from similar services being provided to non-veteran job seekers, thus creating a parallel workforce system that ultimately will be more expensive and less effective. Mr. Chairman, I would ask unanimous consent to include that letter in the record.
Without objection.
Also, just look at the numbers. They speak for themselves. Veteran unemployment was at 6.2% last year, but this year it's only 4.2%. By mandating this reorganization, we're really trying to fix something that we don't know is actually broken. Now, I've been fortunate to sit on this committee for nearly 3 years, and almost every time we meet, sometimes into the early morning hours, we spend hour after hour discussing the perceived shortcomings of the VA, the apparent belief that the VA is unable to effectively take care of our veterans, and the need to streamline the VA system. Now we are going to add more work to the VA's list of things they have to do, at the same time when all we hear from the other side of the aisle is criticism about the work they already have to do. Some people want to privatize the VA because of its bad performance, and then the next minute you want to give them more work. Well, which is it? So I would say maybe this is a good idea. We don't know, but why don't we study it first to look at what the problem might be, how we could facilitate putting the two together, if that is a good solution, before we kind of rush off and make a rash decision to give the VA even more work at a time when they're having to deal with problems that include a hospital in the Denver area and an increasing backlog when it comes to the appeals process. And I yield back.
Thank you. And while I appreciate the efforts of my colleague in offering this amendment, I'm going to oppose it. And a vote for this amendment, in my opinion, is a vote for the status quo and a vote against helping to improve services for unemployed veterans. If this amendment were to be adopted, the transition of the Department of Labor's vets to VA would not occur. Instead, the amendment would require yet another set of studies to be done on the effectiveness of vets in administering job training and placement programs for America's veterans. With all due respect, it's clear that the time for studying this issue is over. Time and time again, Department of Labor has shown that the programs administered under VETS are not a priority. And it's time to bring all veterans employment programs under one roof. Here's a fact. Since 1997, there have been 16 GAO or other government commission reports that have consistently shown that the Department of Labor and VETS have been unable to improve the performance of the state grant program. The estimated 449,000 veterans who were unemployed in August are expecting bold action from their elected leaders and expect us not to continue to waste time and taxpayer resources on another set of redundant studies. I understand this is a major change in the way the federal government oversees job and training programs for veterans, but as the old saying goes, the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result. I also think it's important that we listen to the voices of our veteran service organizations who have traditionally defended vets and their efforts over the years, but have now lost their patience with vets' work and now believe that it's time to transfer vets to VA. Those organizations include the Disabled American Veterans, the Veterans of Foreign Wars of the United States, the Paralyzed Veterans of America, the American Legion, the Vietnam Veterans of America, and the Iraq and Afghanistan Veterans of America. Your packet today includes a summary of their statements and testimony in favor of the move and the creation of the fourth administration at the Department of Veterans Affairs. So to put it in the simplest of terms, this section would transfer the vets' federal staff to VA, essentially trading their DOL ID cards for VA ID cards and state employment service personnel funded through the Jobs for Veterans State Grant Program would continue as state employees. Some have said that VA has enough to do, and adding vets programs is adding too much of a burden to the department. While it's true that VA has a lot on its plate, the department has continued to receive dramatic increases in staffing and resources over the years and could be protected from future budget cuts. I cannot say the same for the Department of Labor's vets. Furthermore, over the past several years, VA has created many programs and positions that are duplicative of those at vets, which in my eyes is a clear indication that the needed outcomes at the Department of Labor just aren't there. Being too busy is not an acceptable answer when we are talking about improving employment services for our veterans. And I believe moving vets to VA and elevating all of these programs to an undersecretary level position will help improve oversight and finally bring the attention that these programs and the veterans that they are serving so deserve. In closing, while I understand Ms. Titus's position, I do believe a vote in favor of this amendment is a vote for the status quo, and our unemployed veterans deserve better. I would ask if there's any other discussion on the amendment to the amendment and the nature of the substitute. Ms. Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I guess I'm the only one on this committee. I've been on this committee for 23 years, and on this committee, I think for the last 3 years, this issue has come up constantly. And for years, we have worked with the VA, with the HUD, and finally we got them doing what they need to do as far as HUD vouchers. And now this, transferring to the Department of Labor, let me just be clear. I do not support it at this time, and I doubt if I ever will. I think we should be working with the VA to fix the problems that we constantly are currently having in the months ahead, considering major reform ideas. I mean, the VA and our hands are full with straightening out the issues pertaining to VA. Now is not the time to add a whole new level of requirements to VA. Now is not the time to remove hastily before a serious question regarding the ability of the VA to perform these new requirements are answered. From both the Secretary of Labor and the Secretary of VA, they are totally against the transfer of the proposal. We can discuss this as lengthy as you all would like, but you need to know that this is one proposal that is dead on arrival. So, we have a lot of issues that we need to work on, but this is not one of them. So, I support Mrs. Titus' amendment, but whether or not we pass this amendment or not, this proposal is not going anywhere. So, I can just yield back.
Thank you. Is there any further discussion, Mr. Waltz?
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I kind of feel like maybe I should quit while I'm ahead after the last one, but I'm gonna weigh in. For some of you on this, this issue has been around a long time, and the irony of this one is that I think several years ago was one of the original folks with this proposal, said they're screwing it up, get it out of there. It's when Congressman Denham and I formed the Vets Job Caucus. Many of you in here were instrumental in that and bringing together those folks. Since that time, I've had dozens of meetings. I've looked into this. I've learned more about it. Progress has been made. I think the concerns are valid. They were valid then. They're valid today. I do think that Ms. Titus and Ms. Brown's point of, at this time, the transition is going to be challenging. We are making, the numbers are coming down on vets unemployment. We're starting to streamline some things. We're starting to move vets skills to jobs. Types of things are happening. So I think it is going to be very challenging. I would add to this discussion, one of us, one of our colleagues, our friend Mike Michaud, has been nominated to take over this position over there at DOL Vets, and that, for me, makes me feel a little better. So I do not deny the issues were real, the inability to deliver on some of that. I can tell you, for what it's worth, of tracking this over the last few years and asking them come in and brief me, they have made tremendous strides on this. I still, the thought of being one-stop shopping is still appealing, until sometimes that one-stop shopping is the VA at times, which is kind of frustrating. So I asked my colleagues, you're gonna make up your mind on this. This is a deep subject, it's been around a long time. There's good intentions on both sides of this, with the outcome being veterans getting the best care and getting them back into the job. I can tell you from my experience of someone who came in fully in the court of move it over there, I'm hesitant now because of some of those transition issues and some of the improvements. And to be quite honest with you, someone like former Congressman Michaud going over there gives me a little bit of pause. So for what it's worth, that's my position, and encourage my colleagues to think about this one, that it's a tough time to move it over there. I yield back.
Thank you very much. Members, I would also bring your attention in the legislation, there's a one-year transition period, so it doesn't happen immediately. You have 1 year before the transition actually takes place. And again, one of the things that I think we need to focus on is we have very little oversight of this particular program because of where it is. It's actually under Ed and Labor. And then when there are bigger issues outside of that, there's very little that we can do to affect the change. And so, you know, the intent is not to, you know, do anything political. It really is to try to bring this program that is vital under the Department of Veterans Affairs, so in fact, veterans can be served better. I mean, 16 different studies, all being negative over the last few years, basically since 1997, I think is probably enough evidence in order to begin the process of making the move. So I would ask if there's any further discussion on Dr. Rowe's on the amendment.
I have just one comment, Mr. Chairman. With Mr. Waltz, I agree. I think I feel a lot better moving Mike Michaud over to VA. Everybody in this room knows Mike well, and he will do a great job at that. I feel a lot more confident. I did a little math on this on the letter from the secretaries, and this isn't going to overburden anybody. You've got these 2,500 job centers out there. We're seeing 1 million veterans. That sounded like a lot. That's only 400 a year. That's 8 a week. That's not a lot of people. And if that's all they're serving, if the VA can't handle this, then we need to give up. So I think we can do that. And certainly I feel knowing that Mike is going to be there, there is a true champion for veterans in that position. We all know on this committee, and I can't think of a better person to be in that. So I wholeheartedly, I'm going to not support this amendment. I think moving it over is a good idea.
Ms. Brown.
Just a question. You know, I recently visited one of those tent cities, and keeping in mind, it is not just VA. We have the homeless problem, but it's a comprehensive problem. It's working with the local, it's working with HUD, it's working with labor. It is putting together a team, and VA cannot be in that team by themselves. And so the idea that, you know, you've got to have all of these stakeholders and partners working together to solve this homeless problem, get the veterans out of the woods. VA got their hands full. And they don't need another responsibility. It's not just adding it up. It is the VA with the stakeholders working together. I yield back.
Thank you, Ms. Brown. Any other further discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Takano.
Very quickly, I just want to register my support for Representative Titus's amendment, which would just require more study. The knowledge that Mr. Michaud is nominated for the position over at Labor gives me far more comfort. But I think I know we've taken some time, I recognize the good intentions on your part and all this committee's part. But I think before making this change, we should take a little more stock. And that's next time my remarks.
Thank you very much. Any further discussion? Since no other amendments were timely filed, the question now occurs on Dr. Rose. We're going back to the beginning now. Dr. Rose, amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute on H.R. 3016. As previously discussed, I will be voting in favor of the amendment and will work with Dr. Rowe to ensure that a fully developed offset is found before it's considered on the floor. All those in favor of Dr. Rowe's amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute will say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. The ayes have it. The amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3016 is agreed to. The question now occurs on Mr. Takano's first amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3016 relating to GI Bill transferability benefits. And as I previously discussed, I'm not going to be supporting the amendment, so I would ask that all those in favor of Mr. Takano's first amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3016 say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. No. The nays have it. The amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3016 is not agreed to. The question now occurs on Mr. Takano's second amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3016 relating to the Advisory Committee on Minority Veterans. And as previously discussed, I will not be supporting this amendment either. All those in favor of Mr. Takano's second amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute will say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. No. The nays have it. The amendment.
Mr. Chairman, I request a recorded vote.
I didn't say it yet. Clerk shall call the roll.
On the amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3016 regarding the advisory committee, Mr. Chairman.
No.
Mr. Chairman votes no. Mr. Lamborn. Mr. Berlarakis? Dr. Rowe? Dr. Rowe votes no. Dr. Beneshek? Dr. Beneshek votes no. Mr. Uelskamp? Mr. Uelskamp votes no. Mr. Kaufman?
No.
Mr. Kaufman votes no. Dr. Winstrup? Dr. Winstrup votes no. Ms. Walorski? Ms. Walorski votes no. Dr. Abraham? Dr. Abraham votes no. Mr. Zeldin? Mr. Zeldin votes no. Mr. Costello?
No.
Mr. Costello votes no. Ms. Radawagam?
No.
Ms. Radawagam votes no. Mr. Bost?
No.
Mr. Bost votes no. Ranking Member Brown?
Present.
Ranking Member votes present. Mr. Takano?
Yes.
Mr. Takano votes yes. Ms. Brownlee?
Yes.
Ms. Brownlee votes yes. Ms. Titus?
Yes.
Ms. Titus votes yes. Dr. Ruiz?
Yes.
Dr. Ruiz votes yes. Ms. Custer?
Yes.
Ms. Custer votes yes. Mr. O'Rourke?
Yes.
Mr. O'Rourke votes yes. Ms. Rice?
Yes.
Ms. Rice votes yes. Mr. Walls?
Yes.
Mr. Walls votes yes. Mr. McNerney?
Yes.
Mr. McNerney votes yes. Mr. Chairman, the vote is 9 yes, 12 no, 2 absent, 1 present.
Could you check that vote again?
Sure.
Could you read the vote again?
Sure. I still have 9 yes, 12 no, 2 absent, and 1 present.
Okay, I apologize. I heard you read it backwards the first time, so I just was double-checking to make sure what the vote. So the amendment does not pass. The question now occurs on Ms. Titus' amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute on H.R. 3016. As previously discussed, I will not be supporting this amendment either. All those in favor of Ms. Titus' amendment in the nature to the amendment in the nature of a substitute 3016 will say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. No. In the opinion of the chair, the noes have it. The amendment to the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3016 is not agreed to. Is there any more discussion on the amendment in the nature of a substitute as amended?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a statement on the amendment.
You're Mr. McNerney, you're recognized.
Well, I want to thank the chairman for including my language from the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3016. It has the GAO audit, the VA budget on a regular basis. This language will help hold the VA officials more accountable. It'll better serve veterans by detecting issues in the budget early so that projects are not delayed, such as the planned French Camp facility in my district and others around the country. It will help ensure the VA better uses its funding from Congress for medical care for veterans. The $3 billion shortfall we saw in the VA's fiscal year 15 budget is unacceptable. I appreciate the bipartisan support in addition to this issue, and I yield back.
Thank you very much. Members, the question occurs now on the passage of the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3016 as amended. All those in favor will say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. The ayes have it, and the amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 3016 as amended is agreed to. And I recognize Ranking Member Brown for a motion on reporting H.R. 3016 as amended.
Mr. Chairman, my strip says I move that H.R. 3016 as amended be reported favorably to the House of Representatives. That's what my script says.
All those in favor of Ms. Brown's script will say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. The ayes have it. The motion is agreed to. H.R. 3016 as amended is reported favorably to the full House. I now call up H.R. 1338. The clerk shall report.
H.R. 1338, to require the Secretary of Veterans Affairs to conduct a study on matters relating to the burial of unclaimed remains of veterans in national cemeteries and for other purposes.
The bill has been circulated in advance pursuant to committee rules, and without objection, the first reading has been dispensed with. The bill is now open for amendment at any point. Who seeks recognition for the purposes of offering amendment?
Mr. Chairman, I have
Dr.
an amendment
Abraham.
In the nature of a substitute at the desk.
Clerk shall report.
Amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 1338 offered by Mr. Abraham of Louisiana.
I ask unanimous consent the further reading of the amendment in the nature of a substitute be dispensed with. Hearing no objections, so ordered. Dr. Abraham, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
The nature of a substitute.
I urge my colleagues to support this amendment in the nature of a substitute to H.R. 1338. This ANS will enable this legislation, the Dignified Interment of Our Veterans Act of 2015, which was introduced by our colleague, Representative Bill Schuster, to advance to the House floor. In 2013, Congress enacted the Dignified Burial and Other Veterans Benefit Improvement Act of 2012, which authorized VA to provide burial benefits in a national cemetery for the unclaimed remains of deceased veterans who had no known next of kin and who did not have sufficient financial resources to cover the cost of their own internment. VA's burial benefits include reimbursements for the cost of a casket or urn, for the cost of transportation to the nearest national cemetery, and certain other funeral expenses. However, during the June 24, 2015, hearing of the Subcommittee on Disability Assistance and Memorial Affairs, which I chair, Representative Schuster testified that there are currently 47,000 unclaimed, uninterned veterans in the U.S. despite passage of the Dignified Burial and Other Veterans Benefit Improvement Act. This raises troubling questions concerning the effectiveness of VA's current policies with regard to the identification and interment of such remains. I strongly believe that the VA should take immediate steps to ensure that the remains of all of our nation's heroes are treated with the deference that they have earned. H.R. 1338 would require the VA to conduct a study and provide Congress with a report on identifying and interring unclaimed remains of deceased veterans. This report would include recommendations on appropriate ways to ensure that unclaimed remains of deceased veterans are treated with dignity and respect. I'm proud to give my support to this legislation and offer this amendment in the nature of a substitute, which would also limit bonuses and awards paid to VA senior executive service employees to an aggregate of $2 million in 2016. Mr. Chairman, I urge my colleagues to support the amendment in the nature of a substitute, and I yield back.
Thank you. I'd ask the members if we could pause for just 1 second. Everybody sit tight. We're about to lose a quorum if we're not careful, and I want to figure out a way that we can do this so that everybody can get a vote and we can move forward. We'll stand in recess for just a minute. Please don't leave. Okay, Ms. Brown has a question.
I guess it's for Congressman Abraham or for the staff. But my question is in terms of burial. It has been brought to my attention that there are no burials, let's say in my area, on Saturdays, which is a real hardship for the families because then it has to go back to the funeral home and then it's done Monday through Friday. And then there are some groups, Jewish groups and other groups, that they need to be buried by the end of a particular day. What is the status of having alternatives, the VA? They don't do burials in my area or in certain areas on Saturdays. It's a question, and it's been brought to my attention, of the hardships on the family because of the additional costs. Most African Americans' funerals are on Saturdays, and they don't have burials on Saturdays. And so then the funeral director have to keep the remains until Monday, which is a hardship. Why is it that we can't have, and without any additional costs, why can't we have burials on Saturdays?
I would have to defer to the VA on that as mm-hmm. far as, you know, why they wouldn't supply personnel or whatever.
We'll look into it.
Yeah.
Congressman Miller.
Yes, we'll be glad to look into it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Members, since we currently have a quorum, I would like to ask unanimous consent that should we lose a quorum, that we would be allowed to pass all amendments and bills remaining on the agenda en bloc, because I don't believe there's any contentious amendments or bills at this point. Any objection? No objection. So ordered. Mr. Waltz, do you have, I guess what we want to do is go ahead and we'll read everything that we're going to be voting on, but do you have a statement on any other bills or amendments?
No, and it's just the Honor and the Guard Reserve Act. You 20 years in the Guard, call yourself a veteran. No added benefits, no cost. I ask all of you to co-sponsor it, and appreciate the chairman's been a champion of this for many years. Thank you. I yield back.
Thank you very much. We are now voting on the following bills. H.R. 1338 as amended. H.R. 1384. H.R. 2360 as amended. And H.R. 2915 as amended. And I would ask unanimous consent that the committee, after the vote, be authorized to make any technical or conforming changes that need to be made without objection. All those in favor of those bills as amended will say aye. Aye. All opposed? No. Motion carries. Ms. Brownlee.
Statements be entered into the record.
Yes. Member statements will be entered into the record at the appropriate place. Would ask now for a motion for Ms. Brown.
H.R. 1338 as amended, H.R. 1384, H.R. 2360 as amended, and H.R. 2915 as amendment. Favorably to the House of Representatives.
There's a motion before us to favorably report H.R. 1338 as amended, H.R. 1384, H.R. 2360 as amended, and H.R. 2915 as amended. All those in favor will say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, no. Those bills will be reported favorably to the full House. And again, summarizing the votes, the committee has voted in to favorably report the full House today, H.R. 3106 as amended, H.R. 3016 as amended, H.R. 677 as amended, H.R. 1338 as amended, H.R. 1384, H.R. 2360 as amended, and H.R. 2915 as amended. And again, I ask unanimous consent the committee staff be authorized to make technical, clerical, and conforming changes to the bills favorably reported today. Hearing no objection, so ordered. I would also ask unanimous consent that all members would have 5 legislative days with which to revise and extend or add extraneous remarks to any of the bills reported favorably today. Hearing no objection, so ordered. Thank you to all the members that stuck around for their attendance today, and the committee is now adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you.